Meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, mein Name ist Jasmin Schomann. Ich leite hier die Akademieprogramme und begrüße Sie herzlich zu unserer heutigen Veranstaltung Sexualethik, Sexualität, Lust, Erotik und Gott. Wir freuen uns sehr über Ihr reges Interesse. Die Veranstaltung war schon seit über einer Woche ausgebucht, was sicherlich nicht nur mit dem bekannten Credo Sex Sells zusammenhängt, sondern vor allem damit, dass wir für den heutigen Abend mit Professor David Biale und Professor Kecia Ali zwei hochkarätige Experten zu diesem Thema zusammenbringen konnten. Auch Ihnen beiden ein herzliches Willkommen. Dies ist die fünfte Sitzung unserer Ringvorlesung zum Thema ethische Fragen in Judentum und Islam, die wir im Rahmen unseres jüdisch-islamischen Forums, stattfindet und die wir mit freundlicher Unterstützung der Allianz Kulturstiftung realisieren. Mit dem Forum will die Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin das Verhältnis von Judentum und Islam beleuchten und eine Plattform für die Auseinandersetzung mit religionsphilosophischen und religionspraktischen Fragen schaffen. Wichtig ist uns dabei, uns nicht nur an Fragestellungen abzuarbeiten, die von außen an Juden und Muslime herangetragen werden, wie das zum Beispiel in der Debatte um die rituelle Beschneidung von Jungen der Fall ist, die im Moment, wie Sie es vielleicht auch wahrgenommen haben, in Deutschland wieder aufflammt. Mit solchen Fragen beschäftigen wir uns natürlich, aber wir wollen darüber hinaus vor allem Fragen aufgreifen, die innerhalb der Religionsgemeinschaften selbst diskutiert werden. Und da zählen Fragen der Sexualmoral und sich daraus ergebende Kontroversen zweifelsohne dazu. Wir freuen uns sehr, dass wir mit Dr. Nahed Samour eine versierte Moderatorin gewinnen konnten, die Sie gleich durch den Abend führen und Ihnen die beiden Referenten näher vorstellen wird. Sie ist Rechts- und Islamwissenschaftlerin und studierte unter anderem in Harvard, Ramallah, Damaskus, London und Bonn, um nur einige Stationen zu nennen. Sie ist sehr viel beim Studieren herumgekommen. Seit 2015 ist sie Junior Faculty an der Harvard Law School, Institute for Global Law and Policy und Postdoc Researcher am Erik Castrén Institute of International Law and Human Rights an der Helsinki University. In ihrer Habilitation arbeitet sie zum Religionsverfassungsrecht. Zu ihren weiteren Forschungsthemen gehören Antidiskriminierungsrecht mit dem Schwerpunkt Religion, Rasse, Geschlecht sowie Islam und Feminismus. Sie sehen, sie ist prädestiniert dazu, heute mit uns die Diskussion später zu leiten. Bevor ich Nahed Samour das Wort übergebe, möchte ich Sie noch darauf hinweisen, dass wir die heutige Veranstaltung gleich auf Englisch führen werden. Und es gibt hier, falls Sie Bedarf haben, Kopfhörer, die Sie noch, gibt es keine mehr. Oh, es gibt keine mehr. Ich hoffe, alle, die einen Bedarf haben, haben auch noch Kopfhörer erhalten. Auf jeden Fall werden auch noch Listen herumgehen, die Sie sich eintragen können, wenn Sie auch in Zukunft Einladungen von uns erhalten möchten. Zum Beispiel, wenn wir im Herbst unsere Ringvorlesung fortsetzen, dann zum Thema jüdische und islamische Perspektiven auf die Menschenrechte. Nun wünsche ich uns allen aber erstmal einen spannenden Abend.
So, good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for joining me, for joining us tonight to what promises to be a quite fascinating and illuminating event. Not only that the Jewish Museum Berlin is welcoming two of the most accomplished scholars of their respective fields in Jewish and Islamic studies, they have invited them to talk to us on sexual ethics, desire, eroticism, and God, i.e. on something that could hardly be more essential to the human being unless you're an ascetic. To unpack questions of sexuality, sexual ethics, and religion, one has to master the religious texts, the historical contexts as they were discussed in the past and as they reemerge in the present. And you have to have a fine ear for contemporary concerns, coming both from within the religious communities as well as from outside of them. Some introductory questions, I think, are the following. One, what do religious texts say on sexual ethics, and what do they not say? Where is text ambivalent? Where is text puzzling? This is important as for a believer text is central. Question two then is, in what context was the text revealed, interpreted, debated? Which texts became canonical? Which majority and minority opinions revered around text? So here the question is one of context. Clearly, this raises the subject matter of who is reading, who is debating, whose voice is authoritative, whose voice is excluded, and how is knowledge situated knowledge? Question three is, how do we deal with text and context of the past with arguments of the present? And how much of what we think is modern has actually been well discussed in the historic past in a way to aid us build solid arguments today? How are we to read a 3,000-year-old Jewish text or a text of the 7th century when the Quran was revealed as people living in the 21st century? How can people of the Jewish and Muslim religion do so, remaining both faithful to text as well as to community issues of the present? And when I mean community, I mean both their own religious communities as well as society at large, of which one is always a member too. What I sketched out is a general way in which scholars of religion and history approach their religious material. Now, sexuality and sexual ethics as a field, I feel, is particularly intriguing and stimulating because it forces us to think about so many binaries, binaries that are either real or imagined. So think about sexuality and sexual ethics as the private and the public, the individual and the collective, practice and identity, the unbound and the ordered, sexuality as love and sexuality as violence, sexuality as something affirmative and sexuality as something repressive, and sexual ethics having to do with every single aspect of this and much more. I'm sure you are immediately getting an idea of the dense web that sexual ethics, sexuality, desire, erotics, and God produce. And as if religion and sex were not already hot topics in and of themselves, the whole thing gets so much more complicated and richer when we will later also talk about positions on religion and sex as minorities within religious communities, and particularly as religious minorities living in secular, possibly increasingly atheist Western majorities. To guide us through this web of ideas, I am delighted to introduce Professor David Biale. David Biale is the Manuel Ringelblum Distinguished Professor of Jewish History with interests that range across the 3,000-year span of that subject. Professor Biale's research is broadly in the areas of Jewish intellectual and cultural history. He has written widely on themes of power, sexuality, blood, secularization in Jewish history, and he is also an expert on Gershom Scholem. His current project is as director of an international team writing the history of Hasidism. The most relevant work for tonight's topic is Eros and the Jews, from Biblical Israel to Contemporary America, which has been translated to French and Hebrew, but unfortunately not yet to German. And for his book, Cultures of Jews, A New History, he has won the National Jewish Book Award. And one of his most recent books is called Not in the Heavens, The Tradition of Jewish Secular Thought. So with this, please, Professor Biale, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much for the kind invitation to speak here at the Jewish Museum now for the second time. It's wonderful to be back. Now, 25 years ago, when I was publishing my book, Eros and the Jews, and I told people I was writing about sex and Judaism, some people said, that will be a very short book. Other people said, no, that will be a very long book, which both of these responses reflect contradictory contemporary attitudes towards Jews and sexuality. In the end, it is a medium-sized book. And I want to share with you some of the primary sources from this study which are taken from the rabbinic tradition, that is the tradition of the Talmud and Midrashim from the first five centuries of the Common Era. But I will occasionally say some things about how these have developed more recently. In the rabbinic tradition, it is said that a man is required to procreate. That is, this is the basis for the commandment to marry, is to have children. A man is commanded concerning the duty of procreation, but not a woman, says the Talmud. Rabbi Yochanan ben Baruch, however, said, concerning both of them, it is said, and God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. Yochanan ben Baruch notices that the verse in the Bible is in the plural, so that it must be addressed to both Adam and Eve, and therefore they should both be required to procreate. However, he is in the minority. The majority say that this commandment applies only to men. What are the consequences of this, or why is it that the commandment applies only to men? Probably basic reason is that a woman cannot be commanded to do something that will threaten her life. So of course, before modern times, childbirth was a real danger. And the rabbis recognized this and therefore said a woman cannot be commanded to do something that would endanger her. But it was also assumed that women would naturally want to have children, whereas men might not. And we'll see how that develops in just a moment. Finally, there is a significant consequence of making this commandment apply only to men and not to women. Because in the Jewish tradition, to perform something that is commanded has a higher value than to do something that is not commanded. And so clearly this creates a hierarchical division between men and women. Only men are required and only men fulfill this commandment because they are commanded. Why would one wish to have children, or let's make it more simple, why would one wish to have sex? According to the rabbis, the sexual drive is called evil desire or evil instinct, yetzer hara. That is, the drive to have sex is labeled as something negative, and yet, if it were not for evil desire, a man would not build a house, marry a wife, or have children. So there is a recognition here that even if this is a negative quality, it is a necessary one. This idea that the sexual drive is negative, the rabbis possibly took from the ancient Stoics, from their idea of the passions, and one should ideally rise above the passions. But if in the rabbinical case, it would not be okay to abandon the passions altogether because one is required to have children, as we saw in the first slide. And so therefore, we have a kind of ancient version of Freud's idea of sublimation. That is, one must take this drive and channel it into a positive direction. Now, one way in which I think the rabbis are different from the Stoic philosophers is that they do not view the body as necessarily negative or distinct from the soul. The soul is always embodied. This is a very important point, because if the soul is always part of the body, then one cannot separate them, and therefore the demands of the body, the desires of the body, must ultimately be positive, even if they could as well be negative. And this is how they become positive, by directing them in the direction of marrying and having children. Now, clearly, from what we have learned so far, the rabbis would not be in favor of celibacy, that is, of taking a vow of abstinence from sex or not marrying. But this is an issue that they actually discuss. So in the Talmud, Ben Azai, a rabbi of the second century, says, He who does not procreate is as if you shed blood and lessen the divine image. So this is very serious. It's as if you committed murder. He may actually be reflecting here the rabbinic idea of what is called hashchatat zera, which means the destruction of seed. That is, male seed, semen, that is not ejaculated into a woman for the purpose of creating a child, is considered to be destroyed. It is actually considered a kind of act of murder, which is why in the Jewish tradition, masturbation is prohibited. And you have a great deal of anxiety over this in medieval, especially mystical texts. But this may go back to the text we are looking at right here. Now, the rabbis responded to Ben Azai by saying, there are those who preach well and practice what they preach, those who practice well but do not preach well, but you preach well but don't practice what you preach. In other words, he preaches that one should marry, but in fact, he himself does not marry. And his answer to them is, Ben Azai said to them, what can I do since my soul lusts for the Torah? The word that's used here is a sexual word. His soul lusts sexually for the Torah. He wishes to, he obtains his sexual desire by studying rather than by an act of sex. The world will have to exist by the hands of others. So he is, as far as we know, probably the only example of a rabbi who takes a vow of celibacy. But we have examples of this in later Jewish history. For example, in 18th century Hasidism from Eastern Europe, there are a number of cases of rabbis who take such a vow, even though it is, generally speaking, prohibited in Judaism. In this sense, Judaism is quite different from Christianity, but there may be some influence of Christian ideas of celibacy on these rare cases that we find in the Jewish tradition. By the way, I should also add that just as the spilling of seed or destruction of seed is the prohibition on masturbation, for the same reason there is a prohibition on homosexuality. Now, it is true, of course, the Bible has a prohibition. The rabbis almost never talk about that. In fact, they almost never talk about homosexuality at all, even though it certainly existed in their world. It's hard to believe that it did not. But from their point of view, homosexual act would be akin to, similar to, masturbation in that it is seed that is not procreative. Now, what of the experience of women? And now we turn to women's conjugal rights. These are the rights that in the New Testament Paul says, he calls the marital debt that a man owes to a woman and a woman owes to a man. In the case of Judaism, it's a one-way street. It is a duty that men owe their wives. There is no reciprocal duty of women or wives to give sexual satisfaction to their husbands. That's an interesting question. Now, a woman could be divorced if she refused to have sex with her husband, but she could demand a divorce if he does not fulfill his duty to give her sexual pleasure, which is quite separate from, I want to emphasize this, quite separate from procreation. So let's read the text, the two texts actually. Rabbi Joshua ben Levi stated, it is a man's duty to pay a visit to his wife when he starts on a journey. This is a rabbinic euphemism for sexual relations. For it is said, and you shall know that your tent is in peace. That is, that the man must have sex with his wife before he goes on a journey. Otherwise, she will perhaps find another man. Is this deduced from here? Surely it is deduced. That is it deduced from the verse in the book of Job? The Talmud brings a different verse. and your desire shall be to your husband. Okay, this is from the book of Genesis, after the expulsion of Adam and Eve from the garden. Then the so-called curse of Eve is that her desire shall be for her husband, and he shall rule over her. This is, of course, a verse that has been used throughout the centuries for the really for the oppression of women. But here it is used in a very different way. That is, the fact that her desire is towards her husband means he is obliged to give her sexual pleasure. And it teaches, they say, that a woman yearns for her husband when he sets out on a journey. So here the interpretation is rather different from the way we often understand that verse in Genesis. Now, this is called in rabbinic Hebrew, onah, which means season or periodicity. That is, that within, a man owes his wife this sexual pleasure on a regular basis. And in a different place in the Talmud, it says, the times for conjugal duty prescribed in the Torah are, by the way, this is not in the Torah. Like many things in rabbinic law, it doesn't appear in the Bible at all. So here are the times, and it goes according to the occupation of the husband. For men of independence, every day. There, it's actually called in the text metailin, which is like peripatetic in the Greek. That is, these are philosophers, or maybe they're rabbis. They must do it every day. For laborers, twice a week. For ass drivers, once a week. For camel drivers, once in 30 days. For sailors, once in 6 months. So it goes according to the occupation, so that it, this is a very pragmatic law. That is, you would not require the sailor to do it every week because he couldn't be there. But this is a very interesting concept. It recognizes that women have the right to sexual satisfaction, and that this is a part of the marriage contract. In fact, in the marriage contract, it says that a man must give his wife clothing, shelter, and onah, sexual satisfaction, on a regular basis. Now we turn to some very different texts, which I think will reveal to us the ambivalence in rabbinic culture. This has to do with sex in the Messianic age. One of the ways to evaluate a culture is to look at how it thinks the ideal world would look when the Messiah comes and we will all live in perfect harmony. And according to this text, these two texts appear side by side, which really gives you the idea that the rabbis are putting together things that are completely contradictory. So the first is, though there is nothing more strongly forbidden than intercourse with a menstruating woman, this is from the Bible, that is, the there has to be a period of abstinence when a woman is having her menstrual period, and then for a week later, so-called white days. And during that period, a man and his wife are not supposed to have sexual relations, or in fact, any kind of touching that might incite sexual relations. So this is forbidden, but in the time to come, that is in the Messianic time, God will permit such intercourse. In other words, the laws that pertain to our world that restrict sexuality will be abandoned entirely, and presumably there will be no more ass drivers or camel drivers, and everyone will have sex every day. That is the implication. And now we have a different text right afterwards. In the time to come, sexual intercourse itself will be forbidden. And you should know that this is true, for on the day that the Holy One, blessed be He, appeared on Mount Sinai to give the Torah, He forbade sexual intercourse for 3 days. That is true. It's addressed only to men. It says the men should not go near their wives for 3 days. So the reasoning here is that since God forbade intercourse for 3 days when He revealed Himself to them for 1 day, In the time to come, when the Shechina, that is God's aspect that dwells in the world, when the Shechina dwells among them permanently, will not intercourse be entirely forbidden? So here we have, I think, conflicting views about sexuality. On the one hand, the idea that sexuality is something so positive that it is being restrained in this world because of evil desire, the yetzer hara. It has to be channeled. But in the world to come, in the messianic times, that will disappear. And now that desire will no longer be evil. On the other hand, the position of Ben Azai now comes in the second text, that is, we will all lust for the Torah and not for sexual relations. And so these are two very, very contradictory views of sexuality. Now, I want to for a moment jump from these texts in the first millennium to the present day. There are certain groups among the Hasidim, particularly in Jerusalem, in Israel, who in fact practice a kind of super abstinence, in which they only have sex one day in a month, and at all other times, men and women are supposed to basically ignore each other. A man is not supposed to ever address his wife by name. They are never to walk together. They are never to look at each other. These are very extreme practices that have emerged actually only in the last maybe 50 or 60 years, since the Second World War. And something that we never saw before in Judaism, I don't think, at least not to this degree. And why this is something we might discuss in the discussion period. Now, back to the rabbis of the first centuries. Oops, sorry. Okay, so you may be wondering if the rabbis discuss such things as sexual positions, a kind of rabbinic Kama Sutra. And the answer is yes, they discuss everything, after all, including this. Rabbi Yochanan ben Dahabai said, people are born lame because their parents overturned their table. Hafchu et ha-shulchan. That is, they had intercourse in a non-missionary position, as it's called. Dumb because they kiss that place. Deaf because they converse during intercourse. Blind because they look at that place. So what he's giving advice to you, that is, if you want to have, this actually is based on ancient medicine, that what the parents are thinking or looking at the moment of procreation will influence the character of the child. This is a quite common folkloric belief as well. And he is advising that if you don't want a child whose legs are damaged, then you will leave the table in the right place. Okay, so it's basically, this is a principle the rabbis call midah keneged midah. A certain action will produce a certain consequence. These are linked. So it sounds here like one shouldn't do these things. Prohibits oral sex, for example, prohibits even talking during the sexual act, and so forth. But then we learn about the halakha, the law, is not according to Yochanan ben Dabai, but rather a man may do as he pleases with his wife. That's the law. His advice is merely medical. And the medical advice is at a lower level of importance to the law. The law says you can do whatever you want. A woman came before Rabbi Judah the Prince. He is the author of the earliest stratum of Jewish law called the Mishnah. Now, by the way, this is something that happens in the rabbinic texts. These are texts written by men for men. These are prescriptions of how men are supposed to behave. And yet, from time to time, women come inside. They ask questions. They challenge. So here the woman says, I have set a table for my husband, but he has overturned it. Okay, so we know what that means now. This is not a meal in the normal sense of the word. Rabbi replied, he's always called Rabbi, by the way, my daughter, the Torah has permitted you to him. What then can I do for you? Okay, so in other words, he says his hands are tied. He cannot help her because the law says that her husband may do whatever he wishes. Now, if you raise the question, as you should, does that mean that if the woman does not wish to, the woman here, it seems, does not wish to have sex in this other position, can she refuse? According to the text we have just read, it sounds as if she cannot refuse. She has to do what he says. But in fact, the story is more complicated because the rabbis recognize that there is such a thing as rape within marriage. That is, that a man who coerces his wife to do something that she does not wish to do in terms of sex can be forced to divorce her. And so this text cannot stand by itself. It requires some modification based on other texts. And we'll see this in the final text that we're going to talk about. No, this is not the final text. Excuse me, we have one more after this. A man once conceived a passion for a certain woman, and his heart was consumed by his burning desire. Okay, so he had this Yetzer Hara was really strong, to the point where, at least it seems, he could have died from this incredible desire. The doctors were consulted. They said his only cure is that she shall submit and have intercourse with him. Okay? The rabbis replied to the doctors. Here again, we have the medical advice versus the rabbinic advice. The rabbi said, let him rather die than that she should submit. Then the doctor said, let her stand nude before him. The rabbi's answer, sooner let him die. Then said the doctors, let her converse with him from behind a fence. Let him die, the rabbi said, rather than she should converse with him from behind a fence. So here we have in this story, which, you know, is a clearly, you know, fictitious or imagined story, we have here the opposite of what we had in the previous case. Because now, you see, it would seem that these two people are not married. Because if they were married, if the woman were married in particular, then the rabbis would have an easy time if they said, no, it's forbidden. And that's all there is to it. It's adultery if they have sexual relations. But the fact that they continue this discussion means they are not married. They could be married, but because of his desire is so strong, he only wants her for sexual purposes. He doesn't really want to marry her. And the rabbis say that in that case, it is absolutely forbidden. And so this, I think, emphasizes this idea that coercion is forbidden according to the law. And finally, this is our final text, my favorite text. Rav Kahana lay under the bed of Rav Shemaya, who was carousing and speaking frivolously with his wife of sexual matters. They're having a good time. Afterwards, Shemaya had intercourse with her. Rav Kahana said to Rav Shemaya, you appear to me like a hungry man who has never had sex before, for you act with frivolity in your lust. Shemaya said to him, are you here? Get out. It is improper for you to lie under my bed. Kahana said to him, but this is a matter of Torah, and I must study. So there's a lot going on in this text. So so Shemaya here is enjoying having sex. Now, those Hasidim that I mentioned a moment ago, who really try to restrict sex as much as possible, also try to minimize the pleasure as much as possible. That is, they have sex dressed, rather than naked. Even though in the Talmud it says that one should have sex without any clothes on, and that that is actually a commandment. Well, they ignore that. Here the issue is the student is criticizing his teacher. And the teacher, of course, quite understandably says, what are you doing under here, under the bed? There's some other stories like this that appear in the same place, one in which the student is hiding in the toilet to watch his teacher, how he does that. I mean, it's clearly not the same as sex, but, and the same thing happens. He finds him there and he says, what are you doing here, get out? And the student answers, but it is a matter of Torah and I must study. So here, he's supposed to learn how one does this, and his way of learning is to actually watch it, not just read it in a book or listen to a lecture, as you were doing. What's interesting then is in our story is that what he has to teach is actually the opposite of what the student expects. The student expects him to be showing, you know, modesty and decorum and doing it in a very sober way. But no, the student learns that you can do it the way Shemaiah does and have a good time. This idea that one goes to the teacher not just to listen to his words, but to actually watch him perform corresponds to a Hasidic saying in the 18th century that a certain Hasid would go to his teacher not to hear words of Torah from him, but to watch him tie his shoes. And I think the same thing is going on in this text. So let me conclude by saying that these rabbinic texts, I think, do reveal to us some fairly contradictory ideas about sex. There are some ascetic ideals. There is the idea that a desire is evil and has to be channeled. And yet at the same time, we also have the idea that sex is something very positive, something that a man cannot coerce his wife to do, but they should both experience some kind of sexual pleasure. Something that the wife enjoys as a duty, and that our last text shows us that the teacher, rather than the student, is the one who is teaching Torah. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Biale, for dealing with a lot of issues that will surely resonate with us for the rest of tonight. So let us continue our conversation by bringing Professor Kecia Ali on board. Professor Ali is a scholar of religion, gender, and ethics. She's a professor in the Department of Religion at Boston University. She's a prolific and extensive writer and masters both early classical and modern questions of Islam and gender. And she writes mainly about the Muslim tradition and covers legal, ethical, and biographical themes. Her book, Sexual Ethics in Islam, which was published in an expanded and updated edition last year, as well as her book, The Lives of Muhammad, also explore more intersections, more modern intersections of Muslim and Western discourses about gender, sexuality, and religion. And these books have become classics for anyone studying Islamic studies. Her most recent book, just published this February, is called Human in Death, and is about ethics and popular fiction. She's currently working on a book called Women in Muslim Traditions, geared towards students and general readership, as well as specialized study of, and where she focuses on consent, captivity, and concubinage in early Islamic law. And please do later read more about her and her work on her website at keishaali.com. But right now, please welcome Professor Kecia Ali here, please.
at an event like this, it's always a mixed blessing to go second, because you can have the last word, but you also find that had you heard the first talk, you would have rewritten yours, and now you can be very disappointed about the things that you won't have a chance to say. I'm really honored to be here this evening, and I thank you all for coming. I also want to thank the organizers for putting this together. It was quite a bit of work to coordinate all of the moving pieces. And of course, I want to thank the Jewish Museum for hosting us. In half an hour, I cannot begin to cover, let alone even really touch on, all of the topics that one could discuss that concern sexual ethics and Islam. One could talk about erudite treatises on the erotic arts. There are plenty of those in Arabic and Persian. One could look at ethnographic accounts of Egyptian women's body stories and erotic folk tales. One could look at historical studies of prostitution and its regulation. And of course, one could spend a significant amount of time just mapping the territory of contemporary online Muslim discussions and debates. Everything from sex toys to civil same-sex marriage how one deals with sexual education for Muslim children and teenagers in the West, to questions like, what do you do when a respected community member is arrested for sexually abusing students at the Muslim school where he's been principal for some time? These are all things just within, you know, the past couple of years that one finds debates for. My own work on sexual ethics has been primarily concerned with the ways in which pre-modern Muslim jurists, so basically the Muslim equivalent of the rabbis, conceptualize licit sex, and also with the significant drawbacks for women in particular, but also for men, of the way they've framed that. As I've shown in a book called Marriage and Slavery in Early Islam, these jurists really drew on the conceptual framework and language of slave ownership to understand many things about the marital relationship. And to these men's mind, licit in the eyes of God was not necessarily the same thing as consensual, although they did concern themselves with consent to marriage, it wasn't necessarily the same as consent to sex. And they did, of course, have a care more in their writings on ethical subjects than in the works of jurisprudence that would be roughly equivalent to the Talmud for women's sexual satisfaction within marriage, although it was primarily a wife's duty, not a husband, so a place where that differed. But even though they were very aware, or at least wrote as though they were aware, about the satisfying feelings of mutual tenderness that women's orgasms could engender in the marriage relationship, they weren't primarily concerned with sexual encounters as a laboratory for developing intimacy or cultivating virtuous selves. Instead, even the ethicists were mostly concerned with ensuring peace in the tent, right? Ensuring that God's boundaries weren't violated, unsatisfied women were liable to stray. Now, I'm well aware that my work on the legal tradition on marriage, divorce, and slavery puts the focus on elements that are at the very least androcentric and sometimes outright misogynist in the Muslim tradition. It emphasizes repression rather than joy. I do want to emphasize that there are key points of connection with the Jewish tradition, and there's a lot to like about the tradition, but that's mostly not what I'm going to talk to you about tonight. I will point out, because as Nahid said, I'm interested in that intersection of Western and Muslim discourses and the ways in which Westerners have understood Islam over the centuries, that for many years, Westerners and Europeans in particular regarded Muslims as disturbingly lax in their sexual morality. The shift to thinking of Muslim women as oppressed victims rather than wanton, lustful termagants happened really mostly in the 19th century with the rise of European colonialism. And there was a similar shift, which happened somewhat later, from portraying Muslim men as gleeful sodomites to portraying them as vicious anti-gay bigots. And that's an interesting and important story. The unhappy stories that one tends to hear today are both because there are very real abuses and problems in a variety of Muslim contexts, and also because of a certain focus of attention, right? What we hear about are the unpleasant things. In any case, for at least 15 years, I've been really thinking about and working towards the idea of meaningful consent and mutuality as a basis for intimate relationships among Muslims. Now, I'm also particularly concerned with my own American context, which colors a focus on the classical tradition as one place that American Muslims have a tendency to turn for thinking about issues of marriage and divorce rather than, say, Egyptian law or Pakistani law or Malaysian law, right? It becomes this idea of the tradition. I've concentrated my research on 8th to 10th century marriage and divorce, and have been really concerned with trying to understand the formative tradition in its own terms, right? And as I said, the early Muslim jurists were deeply guided by a series of analogies that they made between marriage and enslavement, between husbands and master, between wives and slaves, between dower and purchase price, even as they also kept those institutions very distinct in their thinking. Now, my work involves what I hope are relatively straightforward assessments of the pre-modern tradition. Some things that I think are obvious to anyone who read those texts, but perhaps not as clear to other people who haven't. There are a series of hierarchical assumptions that these early Muslim thinkers share, including ones that lead them to privilege free Muslim men over others, at least in social and familial, if not always in spiritual contexts. As modern people, Muslims, non-Muslims, Americans, Egyptians, Germans, we tend to think about companionate marriage as the norm, egalitarianism, including gender egalitarianism, at least to some degree, as obvious and desirable, of wage earning outside the home as the way one works and how work is valued. And as these things are taken for granted, especially but not exclusively by educated elites, especially but not exclusively by people who've been to some degree or another westernized, which is almost everyone to some degree or another, we tend to want to project those things back into pre-modern texts because if that's our tradition, we want to be comfortable with and proud of our tradition, particularly if it's coming under attack by outsiders. So it's a very uncomfortable truth then that scripture and prophetic example, at least as reported, often tend to coexist more comfortably with the patriarchal and hierarchical presumptions of the legal tradition, but presumptions that saturated both of their contexts, all of their contexts, far more easily than they do with certain things that are taken for granted in the world today. Now, does this mean that projects of reinterpretation of scripture aren't possible or desirable? Absolutely not. There's plenty of exciting work being done in this area, and I could actually just really spend the rest of my allotted minutes giving you a reading list, but I'm not going to do that. What I'm going to do instead is talk about polygyny and slavery, two of the topics that are in the updated edition of Sexual Ethics and Islam. These are, of course, also both things that the Bible has present and that the rabbis talked about, although they've largely rejected both for some time, and the story among Muslims is a little more complicated. Again, the stark differences between what the majority of contemporary Muslims take for granted and what pre-modern authorities did are clear when it comes to the regulation both of slave concubinage and polygyny. These were simply matter-of-factly accepted by pre-modern Muslim authorities. They had the demographically unrealistic assumption that men would have multiple sexual partners, which contemporary Muslim discussions almost never assume, even if they permit it, they never take it for granted. And when modern Muslim thinkers discuss polygyny approvingly, they generally do so based on female needs rather than simple male prerogative. Now, I don't want to generalize wildly about contemporary sensibilities, but it is, I don't think, a stretch to claim that today most Muslims would view the 9th century legal luminary Imam Shafi'i's doctrine on permissible sexual relationships, which rendered void a stipulation in a marriage contract that a man couldn't take any additional wives or have any concubines, since it was, quote, narrowing what God made wide for him, as incompatible with fairness and justice. And of course, fairness and justice have been understood in a wide variety of ways by thinkers over the centuries. Slaveholding, then, fundamentally shaped the contours of marriage and divorce, as well as Islamic ethical thought on sex in ways that we often don't fully recognize today. And even as this model of sexual ethics no longer makes sense to a lot of Muslims, it's tricky to think about how one replaces it. When I first made the points that Muslims hadn't really been thinking through questions of consent and coercion and mutuality in ways that I felt were adequate to the contemporary period, I wasn't suggesting then that the early Muslim jurists had fairly represented an unabashedly and necessarily patriarchal scriptural tradition, although sometimes what I've said has been taken that way. I don't think they did. I think they interpreted the Quran and prophetic example in ways that strengthened rather than curtailed patriarchy. And the ways in which human interpretation is operative in the work of the jurists is very clear if one looks at diversity in their doctrines on an array of topics. So they disagreed, for instance, about whether women could contract their own marriages or whether they required a male guardian to contract them on their behalf. Would there be consequences if a husband broke his pledge not to take additional wives? Shafi'i was not the only game in town when it came to that particular provision. These disagreements and the ways that they argued over them, in much the same way that some of the rabbis we saw disagreed, demonstrate, among other things, the human and therefore fallible nature of what some today are happy to try to reduce to a checklist of doctrines and simply call Sharia. But even as folks appeal today to a timeless Sharia, they create palatable new rationales for old doctrines. Just as I noted, many frame polygyny as protection for women instead of simply a man's right, others explain men's unilateral rights to extrajudicial divorce as due to women's greater emotionality and men's greater rationality. That's a particularly modern kind of explanation for this right, rather than linking it to, for instance, men's payment of a dower in exchange for control over the marriage tie. advocates for women's rights also create new rationales, talking about dower, for instance, as a kind of safety net for women, rather than, as the early Muslim jurists saw it, a sum that might have been understood as a gift, but was also legally analogous to the purchase price for a female slave, which in turn, by the way, was linked to a husband's power of unilateral divorce. They talked about this very much as like the power that a master wielded over manumission of a slave. Now, as this makes clear, the early Muslim jurists were very comfortable making these analogies between marriage and slavery, even as they kept firm distinctions between them. These discursive linkages make us very uncomfortable, and hence we don't like to talk about them, but they were really just pervasively ordinary for these jurists. Now, when I talked about slavery in the original edition of Sexual Ethics and Islam, one of the things I said is that people have basically agreed that slaveholding is just one of those things that Muslims don't do anymore. And some of the ways in which Muslims had talked about this included the claim that the Quran and the Prophet were moving on a trajectory toward abolition. More often, the way Muslims have talked about it has just been to ignore the presence of slaves and slavery with which pre-modern texts are saturated. My personal favorite example of this sort of willful obliviousness is a gentleman who wrote a book talking about how progressive it was that Muslim men practiced withdrawal as a form of birth control with captured women without talking about the fact that they were having sex with captured women and not saying anything about these women's consent. It's one thing to have it in a 7th century text when you have it in a text from the late 20th century that's being celebratory. It seems to me a problem. My intent in insistently drawing attention to the practice of slavery and slaveholding in the sacred texts and in the interpretive tradition of Islam is not to hold Muslims up to criticism, although that can be a byproduct, but rather to insist, as the Pakistani modernist Fazlur Rahman and others did well before me, that acknowledging the presence of slavery in the tradition and that acknowledging that the vast majority of Muslims had moved away from it sets precedent for shifting community consensus on other issues. There were only, when I wrote the first edition of Sexual Ethics and Islam, a handful of thinkers I turned up who insisted that slavery had to remain legitimate because God declared it lawful, and all of them were also basically saying, but we really don't do it anymore because the conditions for permissibility are no longer met, or we have treaty obligations that allow us to have that take precedence over the rest. Now, this has gone from being a purely theoretical question to, with the rise of the Islamic State and their capture, abduction, sale, and rape of Yazidi women and girls, to being a really urgent issue. Now, one could choose simply to analyze the actions of Islamic State soldiers as a form of trafficking, or one could choose to analyze it as a pattern of rape in wartime, both of which are common and real. But I think one of the reasons that I chose to talk about in another publication and also in the updated edition of Sexual Ethics and Islam, the ways in which the Islamic State is appealing to the Islamic tradition to justify their actions, and the ways in which their opponents also turn to the tradition, sometimes successfully, sometimes not, is precisely because it seems important to grapple with, even if there is always a place for understanding the rest of the context and the economic and other motivations at stake. Now, just like my work on the early legal tradition is concerned with trying to understand the jurist's logic of marriage and divorce on their own terms, when I talked about the Islamic State rhetoric on enslavement of Yazidi girls and women, because that's how they're describing it, I was really interested in questions of authority and interpretation. So I looked at their propaganda magazine, which celebrates the taking of unbelieving slaves as part of a campaign not only against external enemies, but also against neutered Muslims who have abandoned the practice of slaveholding. There's an author who writes under a female pseudonym in the magazine Dabiq, and she lambasts Muslim men who have come to consider the pure prophetic sunnah of enslavement of captives as rape. She, in contrast, lauds the manly warrior virtues of her Islamic State companions and disdains, and here I'll quote, quasi-men in the lands of unbelief who accept Western human rights norms. Another article declares that those Muslims who deny the legitimacy of enslavement are apostates. But it's not an accident that it's fragile masculinity at issue, right? And a kind of rapacious form of harm to others through which this is going to be reconstituted. Now, in sexual ethics, I show how apologetic discourses of Muslims, even when they're explicitly directed to other Muslims, are often responding to perceived Western critiques. The Islamic State turns this practice on its head, right? Rather than seeking to rebut concerns about Muslim primitivism, they actually deliberately court outrage, right? Like with the campaign of beheadings. What have Muslim reactions and rejections look like? Against Muslim extremists and anti-Muslim critics who argue that Islam is incompatible with the modern world because its scripture holds slavery permissible, and Muslims, unlike others, must supposedly read scripture literally and apply it everywhere, always precisely as stated, many other Muslims have condemned this contemporary slavery and enslavement, although not always wanting to be drawn into a theological debate about how could it possibly be illegal now if God once permitted it, and how could God ever have once permitted it if it's an injustice, because then how could God allow evil to exist in the world, which is obviously a big question. In any case, as part of a larger rebuttal of the Islamic State, a number of Muslim authors wrote an open letter to Baghdadi a number of years ago and made the case that slavery is impermissible, citing changed circumstances and international treaties. The argument was actually kind of a mishmash of assertions of scholarly authority for themselves, discrediting the claims to authority of others, and actually some fairly ludicrous claims about slavery and abolition. As I discussed in a piece elsewhere, they insisted that it's universally agreed that Islam has always aimed to abolish slavery. I do think it's absolutely fair to describe a strong and persistent strand of pro-manumission sentiment in Muslim texts. But there is a difference between manumission and abolition. And in fact, in a later Islamic State document, one of the reasons for keeping the practice of slavery is so that slave owners can continue to earn brownie points continue to have meritorious deeds of freeing slaves, right? So there remains that very real tension. I bring all of this up because I think it's very important that Muslims grapple with the place of slavery in the tradition. And I also think it's really also important to recognize the kind of impossible bind that Muslims are placed in when they're asked to simultaneously condemn what's going on and also be theologians to deal with what's in the 7th century text. Because if you condemn that, then how can you also accept this, right? This is a thing we don't tend to ask other people to do. I want to turn now to something which is substantially more mundane, but also perceived as, in many places, kind of exotic and weird, and that's polygyny. In previous work, I've discussed divorce as one key place where Islamic law operates in majority non-Muslim nations, particularly the US. And American Muslims, interestingly, sometimes do and sometimes don't engage civil marriage and divorce laws when they form and when they dissolve their intimate relationships. Polygyny, which American law does not allow, raises all of these questions about what forms of relationship are approved, what forms of relationship are recognized, and how Muslims navigate those things. Polygyny prompts American Muslims to think about the application of scripture in a variety of contexts, and also about the diversity of women's experiences. Unlike the pre-modern period, when the acceptability and even the normative status of polygyny was a given, but only a small percentage of the population practiced it, in the last century, again, it's become very common to describe polygyny as a solution to certain specific conditions, mostly having to do with satisfying women's needs, or as a measure to protect against illicit sex. But as one polygyny advocate whose husband has a second wife wrote to me when I was sharing a draft of material with her, it's not a matter of defending or justifying polygyny, but acknowledging it. And she writes, "Men having multiple women is not a strategy or a remedy, but a reality since time immemorial." Now, polygyny is not something that I have personal experience with, so when I wrote about it, I drew on a network of smart Muslim women, as well as a recently published study by my colleague Deborah Majid. Because women have such different experiences of polygyny, it became an opportunity to really synthesize material and think through a number of iterations. Now, one of the things that I start with is simply the acknowledgement that women's experiences differ. Women have radically different experiences of polygyny, which is, of course, also true for monogamy. But it is the case that polygyny has, as one self-described survivor put it, a powerful lesson in male sexual entitlement and, quote, a very concrete affirmation that women are expected to put up with less than optimal relationships. Deborah Majid, who does a study of African American Muslim women from W.D. Muhammad's community, where the practice of polygyny is somewhat more common than within other parts of the American Muslim community, advocates for its decriminalization and acknowledges that for some women it can actually be liberatory, but she's very skeptical of it as ultimately a strategy for the survival and empowerment of African American Muslims. That's her phrase. She says that despite the fact that many African American Muslims practice it, I mean, many compared to other communities, still relatively few, that it's really only a small minority where multiple wife marriage is strongly positive. Most men are actually poorly equipped to handle both the financial, but even more so the ethical demands that polygyny makes on them. One of the things that is absolutely true in thinking about polygyny is that there are ethical issues that arise related simply to the American context as well as to the Muslim textual tradition, and issues about sexual double standards that prevail are very much at issue. And thinking more about polygyny in the US context will require engaging a much broader American culture of male sexual entitlement, as well as patriarchal presumptions about female desirability. Now, this comes up against the question of texts, just as with slavery, with the idea that because it's in the texts, it's simply there and must be followed. There are, although few Muslims would simply say that about slavery, there are some who will say that about polygyny, right? And that it can't be a question simply because it's there in the text. That's certainly the position that Imam Shafi'i held in the 9th century. Of course, it hasn't always been the way that Muslim jurists have dealt with it. I want to say something briefly. I know it's very hot in here. I want to say something briefly about the ways in which polygyny is justified, how that responds to the American context, and then I'll wrap up. Now, the justification of polygyny as giving all women the chance to be wives and mothers, which is often how it's framed, as well as to be supported by men in the contemporary US context, reflects a normative centering of marriage and also of male providership that is in some ways profoundly out of step with the reality of women's work, of women's provision, and also with the fact that many women don't get married. It reflects the idea, which is partially real and partially a scare tactic, that there aren't enough good Muslim men to go around. There are surplus Muslim women. It's a kind of commodification of women and a kind of devaluing of women as independent human beings. But it also, to the extent that it takes demographic imbalance as a given, responds in the African American context to the racist incarceration of African American men, but also to the permission for Muslim men to marry outside, which happens with Muslim women and increasingly is being permitted, but not formally spoken about generally, and also to certain kind of assumptions that marriageable men will be older and more successful and that they'll marry younger women, sometimes less educated women, sometimes from back home, and the undesirability or the social unacceptability of Muslim women marrying out or marrying less, marrying down. This is, again, in keeping with broader American norms that expect husbands to be superior to their wives in quite a number of respects. So I think I want to end by saying that it's obvious that polygyny connects to larger social and religious and normative questions, not just about women, men, and marriage, but about family and about romance, about what notions of intimacy take precedence, and also about the proper relationship of individuals to the state, which has been a question for Muslims over the years, much more than it's been a question for Jews. And I want to leave you with a series of provocations and questions more than answers. Is mutuality irreconcilable with polygyny? Must intimate relationships be egalitarian? Must they be monogamous? Must they involve civil marriage? Whatever its perils, polygyny disrupts tendencies toward the unthinking idealization of the monogamous couple. Considering polygyny, just like considering same-sex marriages, by the way, and the gender roles that don't map so neatly there, forces us to be very explicit about our assumptions about male marital authority, about civil law, about fidelity and safer sex, about partnership, about financial obligations, about emotional labor, about household labor, about the centrality of the heterosexual conjugal pair, and the nuclear family. And in thinking about these issues, which is really a lot of sexual ethics, one thing that strikes me as tremendously important is to foreground women's experience, not just texts, and also to foreground the diversity of that experience. There are women who live polygyny very successfully. There are women who live monogamy very successfully. There are women who are unhappy in either or both of those configurations. There are women who are asexual or aromantic. There are women who are lesbians. There are women who are bisexual. And thinking about all of the ways in which relationships work and don't work in American contexts, in Egyptian contexts, in Saudi contexts, in transnational contexts, online, in person, on paper, all of this doesn't leave us with one set of answers, cannot leave us with one set of answers. And my point in raising these questions is not so that we can arrive at a uniform sexual ethic that will apply to 1.5 billion people across the globe, but rather so that Muslims and others can think more creatively and more capaciously about these issues as we go on about our lives. Thank you.
And so to me, it seems that religious texts and their interpretations allow for both a sexual ethics that has in mind an egalitarian approach of love and affection that focuses on sexual pleasures for both, as well as relationships of subordination, usually that of husband and wife or male master and female slave. And this open-endedness of the text sometimes creates some discomfort in facing past and even some present understandings of text. And what both of you impressively did, I think, was to take us on an exercise, namely that there is no shying away from text, that you can run, but you cannot hide from your tradition. What we can win from closely watching the debates within each religious tradition, I think, is not only how we can cherish or rediscover the emancipatory parts of the tradition, like when Professor Biale recounted his favorite story of the student who wanted to learn from his teacher that sex is not only permitted but is also to be enjoyed, and there are similar stories also in the Islamic tradition. And Professor Ali says that the past traditions allow us to learn the important lesson of how to set a precedent for shifting community consensus on many issues. And so I want to open a bit with this shifting community consensus. So with these shifts in mind, which of the concerns, and you've mentioned quite some in both of your presentations, so these concerns coming from within the Jewish and Muslim communities, especially those living in the West, which ones show particular dynamic? Where do you see communities wrestling with text, wanting to shift towards a new consensus where there is like fruitful but also fierce debate in whether or not there should be a new consensus? And again, you've mentioned some of the in your presentations. Is it, you know, it could be, is it sex education at schools? Is it questions on the LGBTIQ movement or sexual abuse within marriage or something entirely different? So just for you to just give us once more an idea of this wrestling that you see is productively done.
Yeah, so in the contemporary Jewish tradition, there's little question that for Orthodox Jews, sex has become the sort of sharp red dividing line between what it, you know, it's the sign of what is modern. And to embrace, for example, some of these texts that I discussed, I've actually talked to very Orthodox Jews about them, and they tell me we interpret them differently because they feel they have to. They have to say that the modern world is all about sexual permissiveness, and for them to they define their identity as on the other side of the line of that permissiveness. And this is a particularly modern phenomenon in the case of Judaism, but I think what's of course will not surprise any of you is that it's true for other so-called fundamentalist religions. And of course, the term fundamentalism is completely inappropriate when it comes to Judaism, which is not a fundamentalist religion, no matter how orthodox. But if we use that as the shorthand for, you know, those who wish to resist the modern world, sex becomes the primary instrument for resisting it.
I think that's true also for Muslims in many ways, right? That the question of where you stand, I would say less than sex, on women, right, on women's rights, on women's leadership, on women's authority, on women's roles, on women's dress. I mean, it's all about women, right? Where you stake your positions, that kind of determines where you fit on a spectrum. In the American context, Muslims don't have denominations in the same way Jews do, so it gets to be a little messier, right? Because mosques, in theory, aren't divided in those kinds of ways. And so thinking about, you know, when you go visit a new mosque, it's always, well, where are the women gonna pray? And, you know, is it okay if I only put my scarf on in the prayer hall, or do I have to put it on before I get into the parking lot, right? So there are a lot of ways in which women become a proxy for moral or immoral. relates to questions about sex and improper mixing and so forth. But those are questions, again, that Muslims have been debating for a very long time.
Actually, I would, here maybe there's a kind of nuance of difference between contemporary Islam and Judaism. I don't think that the woman question is the central question for very, very traditional or Orthodox Jews. It really is the question of sex.
Right.
And so, for example, you don't have a television in your house. Why? Because you might see something sexually arousing on the television. And so for those who cheat, they have it in their closet, and they take it out when they want to see something. But obviously, there are ways in which women are segregated, segregated within the synagogue, segregated in terms of, you know, in the very Orthodox world, in terms of study. Women do not study in the same, in fact, they're not supposed to study the texts that I discussed at all. But these actually are breaking down, and in the Orthodox world, those who are somewhat more moderate, or we call them modern Orthodox, you have actually women who train, they don't call them rabbis, but they are effectively the same as rabbis. So there's been transformations there in terms of women. But the sex question is, I think, the central question.
Yeah, and I actually would agree with you that it's somewhat different. I mean, they're not entirely separable. So a lot of the arguments against, for instance, women leading prayer were about, well, they're bending over in front of men, right? And that it's all about sexual arousal, potentially. But I think on a lot of other issues, it is really, you know, sex is there, but it's not quite... It's not quite the main thing necessarily.
Actually, your example that you gave of prayer, so in it already says in the Talmud that the voice of a woman is erva. Erva means...
Al-mar'a kulluha awra.
Same thing. So erva means literally the sexual organ.
Yeah.
And so in other words, the... for a woman to pray would be to expose men to this, at least theoretically, highly eroticized experience, which is seen as somehow very negative. So it's there, too, in Judaism, of
right.
course.
Please raise your hands now if you have questions or comments, if you felt like something was arousing your interest, and do... do let us know where you see the shifts and the tensions and the dilemmas, or where you want to cherish whatever emancipatory parts you see in text and practice and identity.
Actually, two questions, and one of them to Professor Ali, I think will show how much I actually don't know, because in Judaism, in the tradition of discussion, we have, you're actually supposed to not go against a previous text. You're supposed to say, I'm continuing it or developing it. So you're supposed to be in a positive position to it. And I just would like to know how it is in Islam in that respect. You were mentioning a certain, more... I suppose you were talking about the ghul, the Hasidut ghul, when you were discussing certain streams of Hasidic in Jerusalem today, in which the separation between men and women is very strict. And since I was exposed to texts that were talking about the fact that it had something to do with a personal tendency of the Rav ghul, in the past, I find it kind of interesting and invigorating the idea that there's more of a ideological or more of a general reason why this is happening and not just some sort of anecdotal, personal story. And I'd like to know more about it.
The question about authority and respecting the authority of the tradition is a really interesting one. And so I'm going to talk about the traditional texts and then also some modern interpretive movements. So among Muslims, there are actually distinct legal schools. So Sunni Muslims have four major legal schools. And within those schools, generally, you show a fair amount of deference to the authority of your predecessors. And when you change the position, you say, oh, well, but, you know, Rav, but that's not what they're called, but the imam, he actually had two positions, right? And this is the lesser known of them. Or you fit out an old position with new justification. So there is disagreement within the schools, but it remains within that idea that it's all kind of part of the same thing. Across the schools, sometimes there's very vigorous disagreement and sometimes very vicious argumentation about the failings of the positions of other schools. And you actually see arguments getting stronger over time as people disagree, right? And they figure out how to buttress their positions against these arguments that are coming from the outside. That's within sort of the Muslim equivalent of the rabbinic tradition. You also have, in the last few centuries, a kind of scripturalist, almost Protestant kind of tendency, which you see within the people that will very unsatisfactorily call fundamentalists, but we could also call a lot of progressives in the contemporary space also very scripturalist in their tendency to bypass the authority of this tradition, either because it gets too much into the weeds or because it's overly patriarchal, and to go direct to the text and kind of arrogate to themselves an interpretive authority, which of course then involves creating new patterns of interpretation and new methods, which is a different question entirely.
On your question about these Hasidic groups, so they are the largest and the most extreme is the Gur, or Ger, which comes originally from Poland. And the second is the Slonim, which comes from roughly Belarus. And the third is the Toldos Aharon, which comes from Hungary. They differ from each other in terms of, they all use the language of Kedusha, which means holiness. In other words, these regulations, they're called takanot, or regulation, holiness regulations. They are not generally available to the general public. You have to have access to them to be able to see them. One of my colleagues in this project that was mentioned that we've just completed, a history of Hasidism, Professor Benny Brown from the Hebrew University actually has, he's had access to these texts and has written about them. In the case of Gur or Ger, they're very, very extreme. Oddly enough, though, the women of Ger are considered to be among the most independent women of the Israeli Hasidic world. And there may be even some connection here. That is, they have to basically develop a life apart from their husbands, because the relation with the husband is very, very circumscribed, very controlled by the regulations. So now the question is, why did these groups develop these extreme positions? Whereas you don't find other Hasidic groups with anything similar at all. I mean, they all follow a fairly rigid variety of Jewish sexual practices, but nothing as extreme as this, which one doesn't really find anywhere else. A woman can't walk together with her husband; she has to walk behind. She can't ever touch her husband. Her husband can't address her by her first name or any of these kind of things. So we don't really know. I mean, I think that the one factor may be that in the ultra-Orthodox or Haredi world, as we call it, there is a great desire of different groups to demonstrate that they are more Haredi than other groups. They are more Orthodox than, you know, than the Pope, as we say in English, more Orthodox than others. And one of the ways you do this, and to quote a different authority, Freud called it the narcissism of small differences. That is, you demonstrate your difference by either by your clothing, and they all have different clothing, which they have developed, you know, only in the last century or less, that distinguishes one group from another, as well as their practices. And so these three groups may be trying to distinguish themselves from other groups. For example, the Toldos Aaron, which is a very small Hungarian group that followed a kind of charismatic figure named Rebarele, they may be trying to distinguish themselves from much larger Hungarian groups like Satmar, which is by far and away the largest. So it may be working that way, that the extremism in the sexual area is just one example of extremism generally as a way of distinguishing yourself from other groups. But we don't really know well enough to say for sure.
So I hope my question will fit. It's to Professor Biale. It's about the knowledge of how to please a woman is passed by the rabbi to the men. Like, is there also a knowledge of, like, women and how this is passed is one thing, and the other one is, like, the story of hiding under the bed. Is there any connection that one could draw to porn?
Yes, the answer is that there actually is such literature, which is, again, a kind of not available in the library, but is given to men before they marry, usually immediately before they marry. They have a kind of an audience with a counselor or a guide who will either orally give them instructions or will give them literature, depending on which group we're talking about. Which will generally give them instructions of how they're supposed to do this. Now, I mean, as you can imagine, a highly segregated world where men or young boys have no interactions with any girls except perhaps their sisters until the time of marriage, and they've been completely segregated from women. And they marry now in recent times, it's, you know, age somewhere between 18 and 20. In earlier years, up until probably the middle half to two-thirds of the 19th century, the common practice among Ashkenazi Jews was to marry at age 13. And there is a kind of a literature of trauma that was written about this by maskilim, that is, by those who advocated a modern form of life, but they usually came from this world, and so they would write autobiographies in which they would describe the trauma of, at age 13, being forced to have sex with a usually 12-year-old girl. But that trauma actually probably exists today as well. Even though they're marrying later, because they have absolutely no interaction with members of the opposite sex. It's interesting that because consummation of marriage is actually, although it doesn't take place in public, but it has public consequence, if it doesn't happen, then there will be a discussion of why didn't it happen. And that discussion could be quite public. So there is an odd way in which this world, which values modesty as one of the highest elements, in fact, in the instructions given to the young grooms, in the discussions if there is some kind of sexual malfunction, it all of a sudden becomes a very public matter. And that's a kind of interesting contradiction in that world.
Kecia, you presented sexual ethics in relationship to the legal tradition in Islam. I would like you to reflect more broadly if you think that what are the resources in terms of the Islamic tradition one can be thinking about in terms of sexual ethics, firstly, and then more contemporarily, what do you think are the source of engagement? Because clearly so much of the legal tradition is so limited.
Those are terrific questions. And given that you've written a book where you talk about Ibn Arabi and his mystical thought as a resource for thinking about eroticism, for thinking about ethical relationships, I think that's obviously one place to turn in the pre-modern tradition. There are plentiful narratives, both scriptural narratives, right, and Muslim interpreters, women interpreters, feminist interpreters, gender-sensitive interpreters who don't necessarily claim the label feminist, have tended mostly to focus on the legal verses of the Quran, the ones where very often gender-based differentiation is at play, and where marriage is often at issue. But narratives around female agency, narratives around intimacy are also there and potentially a resource to turn to. Likewise, there is a vast tradition of ethical reflection, which, as I said, tends to still be really androcentric, but insofar as, for instance, the Persianate ethical tradition, which Zahra Ayyubi is writing about, recognizes women as equal persons, right, that becomes also a place to think about with educable selves and souls. That's potentially a resource, particularly if one works with them to understand what are the particular kinds of biases that their interpreters had, what are the particular kinds of insights that they bring, and to reimagine that. There's also a tradition of erotic writing. There's also a really rich tradition of love poetry, of folklore stories about chaste love, about passionate love, about deranged love. I mean, they're within the Persianate tradition, within the subcontinent tradition. And the other thing that I think is really a resource, to the extent that one can have any kind of access to it, is, of course, personal reflections of female Muslims who've lived over the centuries. And while there are far fewer women than men who have left texts, there are some. And I think that those haven't been exploited as resources to the extent that they may be. The one other thing that I'll suggest is the biographical tradition around the Prophet, right, is susceptible to many, multiple readings, and I think that women have begun to engage that tradition and look there for resources, but I think there's a lot more work to do with that. In the contemporary tradition, I think that what women are starting to do in ways that have a lot of potential is to be in conversation about women's life experience, as to be sort of honest about the ways in which women's life experience becomes a framework for reading texts. So the knowledge production that's being done by the women involved with Musawwa, as partly reflected in the Men in Charge book, Men in Charge question mark book that they've put together, or in the Life Stories project that they have available on their website. I think that's very, very useful and meaningful. Deborah Majid, in her study of African American Muslim women and polygyny, uses what she calls a Muslim womanist ethic, which is taking Muslim women's experiences of polygyny rather than the legal tradition or the scriptural text as a starting point. It doesn't mean she doesn't look at those things or at men's interpretations, but it's filtered through how does this actually affect women, right? Are women experiencing justice? Are women experiencing flourishing given particular kinds of interpretation? This is often controversial. If you say, well, women's experience should get a voice here. But it's, of course, true that the medieval thinkers were men. Many of them were slaveholders. Some of them were polygynists. And their experiences were, of course, a basis for how they approached the text. It just goes unacknowledged. And I think that that's ripe for change.
So I wanted to add maybe a Jewish parallel to some of what you've just said, and that is the Jewish mystical tradition, or Kabbalah, which has been exploited or used by contemporary Jewish feminists, because in the Kabbalah, God is described as both male and female, and the male aspects and female aspects are in a constant state of sexual intercourse with each other, and it's extremely erotic, actually, in the way it's written. The problem is that the mystics were all men, their readers were all men, and when they speak of the feminine in God, they seem to be directing their erotic energies towards the divine and not towards human beings. And in fact, we can see this in the case of Hasidism again in the 18th century, where we have texts that refers to the erotic relations between the Hasid and the female aspect of God, which is described as an act of prayer, as an act of sexual intercourse. But of course, that same Hasid is supposed to abandon his wife. And so the mystical tradition looks like it could be useful, but in situ, it sits in Leben, it's not that promising.
Thank you. One more over there.
Ich habe eine Frage zur Pornografie. Und zwar, man denkt immer, dass Pornografie wäre ein Phänomen der freien Gesellschaften. Aber die Statistiken im Internet, die sprechen eine ganz andere Sprache. Nach den Statistiken ist die Pornografie ein Problem der religiösen Staaten. Also am höchsten, die höchsten Ausschläge in der Statistik in der Konsum von Pornografie liegt im Iran. Das ist ja auch der religiöseste Staat der Welt. Ja. Heißt das nicht, dass die religiöse Sexualethik den Menschen mehr Probleme macht als die freie, selbstverantwortliche Ethik?
So I'll give a quick start to that. I think I heard Egypt rather than Iran, but I think basically it's less an issue of religious sexual ethics and more an issue of unemployed young men who cannot afford to marry, right? And with a set of social assumptions about what is necessary in order for socially to make a marriage, it becomes very difficult. I do think it's understating the case to talk about pornography not being an issue in the United States, right? It's definitely an issue. It's an issue for liberals, it's an issue for conservatives, it's an issue for evangelical Christians, it's an issue for Muslims. It's simply an issue. And I think that one of the things that we notice with pornography, if we pay attention, is that many of the issues around power and androcentrism and misogyny that we grapple with in our textual traditions and in our religious traditions are also very much at evidence in the way pornography is made, in how it's viewed. And so, you know, patriarchy finds a foothold in a lot of different places.
Yeah, I don't know how would one go about proving this. That is, what statistics one actually has that would either prove or disprove your thesis. The thing is that I can say that the Orthodox Jewish world is very afraid of pornography, and therefore Orthodox Jews, I'm talking about so-called ultra-Orthodox Jews, are not supposed to have a iPhone or, you know, a smartphone, except if it's what's called a kosher phone, where it blocks certain sites. But I think the reality is that, anybody who wants to have access, I mean, what the internet has done is it's given people access to things that they that were harder to get before. And I think that, as Kecia, I think, correctly says, applies to everybody. Everybody who has that desire, evil desire, as rabbis say, will find a way to get access to this. And I'm not sure if it's necessarily religious people or secular people. per se.
Can I just also leap in and say the internet has made it possible for people to have access to things they didn't have access to before, keyword searchable Quran, right, hadith databases, YouTube sermons, lots of religious texts. So, I mean, the internet is a very scary thing, and it's very scary for a lot of reasons, right? And it both makes accessible some very problematic things, and it also creates new modes of communicating about sacred things in ways that are sometimes very exciting, and sometimes very disturbing. If you read the comment section of, you know, articles about woman-led prayer or about polygyny or about, you know, virtually any topic having to do with Islam and gender. But I do think that since David and I both deal with texts and primarily with authorities who are recognized as authorities on those texts and who have very subtle and very intricate conversations where they assume that not only does everybody know the text's cold, everybody knows the history of the debate, and you know, there's a lot that doesn't have to be said, that really shifts when people come into the conversation today and sort of pick out something and proof text on that basis. And so contemporary conversations around issues of sexual ethics in Judaism and Islam are very different because of that democratization.
Yeah, I want to underline that. I think that the internet poses for very religious communities an attack on authority that can't be underestimated. And I think that's where the danger to those people lies, much more than in pornography per se.
Yeah, I was just wondering if there are any central texts regarding lesbianism or generally how these traditions see lesbianism. Thank you.
In the case of Judaism, homosexuality is banned, or it's seemingly banned, by the Book of Leviticus. Lesbianism is not discussed because there's no issue of the wasting or destruction of seed. Then it doesn't fall under any obvious legal category. There is a mention in the Talmud of something that seems to be lesbianism. Nashim misololot, whatever exactly that means, the rubbing together, something like that, and it's not condemned. Maimonides in the 12th century does condemn it. You know, I don't know to what extent he may be influenced by his Islamic surroundings. That for that I, you know, defer to Kecia, but. It's barely described, barely discussed. I mean, even less than homosexuality, which, as I said in my talk, is almost never discussed either.
Yeah, I mean, there is a verse in the Quran that is sometimes interpreted to refer to lesbianism. Basically, although pre-modern jurists talk about same-sex relationships between women, mostly for them, if it doesn't involve a penis, it isn't sex, right? And so it's just not a major preoccupation. What's very interesting is that today one finds kind of the super category of homosexuality where male same-sex acts and female same-sex acts become instances of a broader category of homosexuality, right? Rather than different, and in the case of female same-sex activity, lesser offenses. If you're interested, Samour Habib has written a book on this topic, and I give other references to the discussions in the chapter of sexual ethics where I talk about same-sex intimacy.
So I want to close up by saying that Kecia Ali said, surely there cannot be like one universal sexual ethic for all the people of the world. So this cannot be the aim of this event or any other events. But I think this event might have helped us consolidate quest to pose more questions, consolidated the encounter to pose more questions on sex or sexual ethics past and present, and to help us foster the Jewish-Muslim encounters in Berlin and beyond. And before I want you to join me in thanking Professor Biale and Professor Ali, please allow me to also direct your attention to the next event in the Ethical Questions series at the Jewish Museum in Berlin. This is going to be an event on environmental ethics on July 13th here at 7. And the title of the event in German is Der Hüter als Herr oder Hüter der Schöpfung. And please also come back for another set of, I think, really pressing questions in environmental ethics. And now please join me in thanking Professor Biale and Professor Ali.